Hello, I'm Mohammed Noor. I'm a biology professor at Duke University. I'm an occasional science consultant for the Star Trek universe. I'm very excited to talk with you today about a topic which is often misunderstood in science fiction and fantasy TV, and that's specifically mutations. So I want to go over that using a, shall we say, instructive episode of Star Trek Voyager. So let's dive right in.
So this is from a rather infamous episode of Star Trek Voyager called Threshold from the second season. So in this episode, following a warp 10 flight, which is supposedly the maximum possible speed anybody can go, our hero, Tom Paris, he grows a new heart. He has some other changes supposedly coming from new mutations. I'm going to read a little bit of dialogue from the middle of the episode. The doctor says, his body's going through some sort of mutation. His DNA is rewriting itself. To what end, I don't know. Captain Janeway says, can you stop it? The doctor says, so far, nothing has worked. The mutations are unlike anything in Starfleet medical records. His internal organs are being rearranged. Some have atrophied and been absorbed into his body, and there are at least three others that have appeared and have no identifiable function at all. So what happens next is even more extreme. Tom Paris becomes some sort of amphibious creature who kidnaps Captain Janeway. They fly off in a shuttle. She becomes an amphibian too. They make some amphibian babies. And somehow, the doctor is able to fix or reverse all this by the end of the show. Though not the babies. They get left on some planet as is. Okay then, a lot to unpack here. Let's start by talking about mutations. So as you've seen in some of my other videos, perhaps, DNA has building blocks called nucleotides. And they come in four flavors that we refer to using the letters A, C, G, and T. Now, DNA is assembled onto chromosomes found inside of cells in your body. Now, inside our bodies, our cells divide all the time. They're always making new cells from the old cells. And the DNA code along these chromosomes from the original cells gets put into the new cells. It gets transmitted to the new cells. So these copies are good, but they're not quite perfect. So a high estimate for the error rate might be something like 1 in 10 million of the nucleotides being copied wrong. Now, those errors then change the code that's in the subsequent cells, such that a G in an old cell might be copied as a T in the new cell. That is a mutation. That error rate, you know, 1 in 10 million, might sound pretty good. You know, I couldn't do that. But when you have 6 billion of these nucleotides in every cell, that means that maybe hundreds of errors are happening almost every time one of those cells divide. So what that means is, for example, if you look at your fingers, each finger may have slightly different DNA than some of your other fingers. Isn't that shocking? Now, where the mutation happens along the chromosome can be pretty random. Now, there's some spots along the chromosome that might be a little bit more likely than others to get a mutation. Generally speaking, you're very, very rarely going to see exactly the same mutation pop up more than once. So why do we get these mutations? Why are these copies not perfect? Well, it's partly the machinery in our cell that makes copies isn't perfect. It tries, but copying 6 billion nucleotides perfectly is pretty hard. Additionally, things from the outside can sometimes also lead to a higher risk for mutations. So, for example, radiation like ultraviolet light from the sun is a big one, and that can lead to some problems. So, what is the consequence of having a mutation? Often, it's nothing. The cells divide like normal and do their thing. What could happen, though, is mutation could lead to uncontrolled cell growth or cancer. Now, this might be from some external influence like ultraviolet light from the sun messing with DNA in a skin cell to make it cancerous, or it may be just random. It may just have happened because of an accident in the copying process. But you have to remember, every cell that comes from the cell with the mutation will inherit that mutation. So it spreads in your body. Now, here's an important point. Mutations in a skin cell don't affect the next generation. They don't get into your kids because skin cells don't ever become sperm or eggs. So mutations in them don't go on to the next generation. But let's talk about sperm and egg for a second. Now, mutations in a sperm or egg cell do get passed on to your offspring. So the average mutation rate for gametes like sperm or egg, and that'll affect the next generations, is a little bit lower than it is for, say, skin cells. It's maybe more like 1 in 100 million. Now, it's higher actually for sperm than for eggs. One recent study estimated that fathers on average may give 2 to 3 mutations per year of their age at the time of conception to the sperm that make their offspring. And that's because their cells keep dividing as the dads get older before they make the kid. But no matter what, we have many, many mutations relative to our parents. Maybe like 100 or more. So you are a mutant. Now, this is different from what I talked about before, in that a mutation you get from your parents will actually be in all of your cells, not just some. It's in you when you're a one-celled embryo, and it gets copied thereafter to every subsequent cell as you grow and develop. So all those cells will be different from your parents in some way. Now, again, the effect may not matter. It may cause a difference in, I don't know, hair color. It may give you a superpower. Probably not that one. Or it may cause you to be a little bit more likely to get some disease. So again, the punchlines from what I've said so far is where a mutation happens is pretty random. Again, there's some spots on the chromosome that might be a little bit more likely than others to get it. But again, you really, really, really rarely see the exact same mutation pop up more than once, right? The effect is unknown because the change is random. So there could be no effect. It could be better, though that's pretty unlikely, or it could lead to some sort of problem. Usually it's no effect. And finally, the effect propagates as the cell divides to the cells that come from that original cell. So coming back to this episode, there is a few scientific leaps, shall we say. First, Paris and Janeway both seem to get the same mutations because they both changed into the same form. They both developed in the same sort of amphibian. That's pretty unlikely. Second thing is these changes happened in multiple cells of their body, and yet the new cells were still able to work together to make healthy organs and even healthy babies that look like mom and dad, so clearly got into their sperm and eggs too. Again, really, really unlikely. And finally, that effect happened way too fast. I mean, it's way faster than the rate of cell division. Like, they had a change that happened just over the course of hours or days. But for example, heart muscle cells, which you remember Tom Paris grew a new heart, heart muscle cells divide really slowly, like over months. The more likely outcome of having a really high rate of mutation is cancer and probably death. Now, they did say in the episode that somehow this was tied to a future evolution of humans, so that maybe these mutations aren't as random as normally happens, but somehow it's tapping into a future thing. But maybe there's some space, timey-wimey stuff that happened. That's outside my biology wheelhouse, so I'm not going to go there. But there is an interesting plot twist. I want to talk for just a second about predatory scientific journals. Now, normally, a scientist does some sort of study. They have some cool results. They write up the results into a manuscript, and they send it to a scientific journal. Yay! There, at the scientific journal, two or three other expert scientists will look it over. They'll give some comments. They'll correct some mistakes. And then maybe the authors will pay a little bit of money to the journal to publish the work for others to read. So that's how science gets out there. In the past decade, this has sometimes gotten corrupted by what are basically fake scientific journals. Now, what they do is they take a scientist's money, they take their manuscripts, and they just post the work without any comments or corrections. So they're called predatory scientific journals because they literally just pay to publish even if the science is bad. Well, someone took advantage of this, and there's a paper that appeared in a few of these predatory scientific journals a few years ago. I'm showing you that paper now. You may recognize some of the authors' names. Tom Paris, Catherine Janeway. Yes, it's the Star Trek Voyager characters. If you look at this paper, the methods and results sections basically just recount the episode in science speak. If you're interested, I'll put the URL for it in the credits if you want to look it up. So maybe the science here is good since it's published.
At least there were some lessons that we could learn from that episode, huh? Well, thank you again for tuning in to BioTrekkie Explains, and I'll see you next time. Bye.